Hello students, I'm Dr. Veena P, Assistant Professor of Physics. This is my second video on diffraction of light for BSc Physics students, in which I am speaking on Fresnel's half period zones and construction of zone plate. Fresnel explained diffraction and confirmed wave nature of light. Let us understand what are Fresnel's half period zones and calculate the amplitude at a point which is at a distance from a plane wavefront. To move ahead, we have to know Fresnel's assumption. We know that a point source produces a spherical wavefront and an extended source produces a plane wavefront. First, a plane wavefront is produced using an extended source. Then the plane wavefront was divided into large number of small elements or zones, and they are called as Fresnel's zones. Each zones further produces secondary wavelets, or each point on the zones works as secondary sources which moves further. So the combined effect of all secondary wavelets from each zones will be the resultant effect at the external point, which is placed at a distance from the wavefront. The resulting amplitude of all the secondary waves at a point depends on the distance between the zone and the point. If the distance between a particular zone and point is more, then the effect will be less, and if the distance is less, the effect will be more, means the effect of zone on the point is inversely proportional to its distance from the point. And the third assumption is the effect at the point also depends on the angle formed by the normal which connects each zone to the point. This was explained by obliquity factor k is equal to 1 plus cos theta divided by 2. If the angle is less here, effect is more, and if the angle is more, then the effect will be less. Now let us see how to make Fresnel's half period zones. First, we have to take a plane wavefront ABCD and an external point P at a distance B perpendicular to the wavefront ABCD. Next, the wavefront is divided into number of half period zones at the point P so that we can calculate the resultant intensity at P due to the wavefront ABCD. Take up this figure. ABCD is a wavefront and P is an external point at a distance B from the wavefront. The wavefront is divided into zones. Spheres are constructed with O as center and radii equal to B plus lambda by 2, B plus 2 lambda by 2, B plus 3 lambda by 2, and so on. These spheres will cut out circular areas of radii OM1, OM2, OM3, etc. on the wavefront as shown in this figure. Each points in these areas produces secondary wavelets which moves towards the point P. The circular region with radii OM1 is first half period zone. Draw a normal from the first half period zone to the point P, that is a line from M1 to P. The portion between first circle and second circle is called second half period zone, and area between second circle and third circle is third half period zone, and so on. Similarly, draw lines from M2 to P, M3 to P, and so on. Now, the Fresnel's half period zones are constructed. These circular zones are called half period zones. These zones are shown as line diagram in the second figure. Each zone differs from its neighbor zone by a path difference of lambda by 2. That is, light rays from O travels a distance B and reaches P. The path difference of the light that leaves O to P and M1 to P is lambda by 2. Similarly, the ray of light that leaves M1 to P and M2 to P has a path difference of lambda by 2 and so on, etc. Since the path difference observed is lambda by 2, these zones are called half period zones. Let us calculate the radius and area of half period zones. From the figure, O is the pole of the wavefront with respect to P. OM1 is the radius of first zone. P is the point at which the resultant intensity has to be calculated. So OP is equal to B, OM1 is equal to R1, OM2 is R2, and so on. M1P is equal to B plus lambda by 2, M2P is equal to B plus 2 lambda by 2, etc. To calculate the radius of the half period zone, let us take up the right angle triangle POM1. So from this triangle, PM1 square is equal to OP square plus OM1 square, or on transposing, OM1 square is equal to M1P square minus OP square. So OM1 square is equal to B plus lambda by 2 whole square minus B square, which is equal to B lambda plus lambda square by 4. Since lambda square by 4 is a small value, we can ignore it in this equation, and we will finally get OM1 square is equal to B lambda. So the radius of the first half period zone is OM1, which is equal to R1, which is equal to root of B lambda. So using this radius, we can calculate what is the area of the first half period zone. It is equal to pi R square. So instead of R, we can put up the value of R1, that is equal to pi into OM1 square, which is equal to pi into B plus lambda by 2 whole square minus B square, which is equal to pi into B lambda plus lambda square by 4. Again here, you can ignore the value of lambda square by 4, and hence you will get pi B lambda. Similarly, for second half period zone, the radius is OM2. Considering the triangle POM2, we get OM2 is equal to R2, which is equal to root of 2B lambda, and the area is calculated to be 2 pi B lambda. So the area of second half period zone is pi into OM2 square minus OM1 square, which is equal to pi into 2B lambda minus B lambda, which is equal to pi B lambda. Thus, the area of each half period zone is equal to pi B lambda, and the radii of first, second, third half period zones are root of B lambda, root of 2B lambda, root of 3B lambda. So we can conclude the radius of half period zones are proportional to square root of the natural number. The area of half period zone is constant, and it is dependent on the wavelength of light and the distance of the point from the wavefront. Now we know the construction of Fresnel's half period zone and have calculated radii of each half period zone and the area between successive zones. Now let us calculate the amplitude and intensity at point P due to the waves emerging out of the half period zones. Let M1, M2 to Mn be amplitudes of the disturbances at P due to first, second and so on till nth half period zones. The magnitudes M1, M2 etc. are in continuously decreasing order. Since the path difference between the waves reaching P from any two consecutive half period zone is lambda by 2, the waves from consecutive zones reach P in the opposite phase. Therefore, if the amplitude due to first zone is positive, amplitude due to second zone will be negative, and that due to third zone is positive, and so on. So the amplitude m2 is equal to m1 plus m3 divided by 2 and so on. Earlier we have studied the Fresnel's assumptions that the resultant effect at the point P due to the secondary wavelets from all zones is the combined effect of secondary waves emerging from each zone. Since the wavelets from two consecutive half period zone meets in opposite phase at P, the resultant amplitude can be written as A is equal to m1 minus m2 plus m3 minus m4 and so on when the number of half period zones is odd. So on manipulation we get the next equation, but m2 is equal to m1 plus m2 m1 plus m3 divided by 2 and m4 is equal to m3 plus m5 divided by 2. On substituting these things in the above equation, the intermediate terms cancels off, leaving behind first and the last term. Now the resultant amplitude A becomes A is equal to m1 by 2 plus mn by 2 if the number of half period zones is odd, and A is equal to m1 by 2 minus mn minus 1 divided by 2 if n is even. If the whole wavefront is unobstructed, then the number of half period zone with respect to P is infinite. That is, n tends to infinity. As the amplitude is of gradually diminishing order, mn and mn minus 1 tends to be 0. The resultant amplitude at P now becomes A is equal to m1 divided by 2 because mn and mn minus 1 diminishes to 0 or tends towards 0. Hence, we also know that the intensity of a wave is directly proportional to square root of the amplitude of that wave. So we get I is proportional to m1 square by 4. Now we come to a conclusion with this equation. The intensity at P is only 1/4 of that due to the first half period zone. Half the area of the first half period zone is effective in producing the illumination at point P. A small obstacle of the size of half the area of first half period zone placed at O will screen the effect of the whole wavefront, and the effect due to the rest of the wavefront will be zero. Considering the rectilinear propagation of light, the size of the obstacle used is greater than half the area of first half period zone, and hence bending effect of light around the corners of obstacle cannot be noticed. Let us summarize the content studied till now. We constructed half period zones in a plane wavefront and found the radii of half period zones to be square root of the natural numbers. Zone plate works on the above principle and confirms rectilinear propagation of light. Let us see the construction of zone plate. If odd zones are blackened, that is 1, 3, 5 zones are blackened or made opaque, and the even zones like 2nd, 4th, 6th and so on are made transparent, then such zone plate is negative zone plate. And if the even zones are made opaque and odd zones to be transparent to light, then such zone plate is called as positive zone plate. But the radius of the zones should be taken as square root of the natural number. This concentric circles should be drawn on a white paper with the proposed radii, and its reduced photograph should be taken. Zone plate is a diffraction screen in the form of transparent glass plate such that light from every alternate zones are cut off. The focal length of zone plate can be calculated using the radius of half period zones. That is, first half period zone has a radius R1 is equal to root of B lambda, and second half period zone has a radius R2 is equal to root of 2B lambda, and so on. Similarly, the nth zone will be having a radius root of nb lambda, or if you square it, R n square is equal to n b lambda. In terms of focal length, the radius can be written as R n square is equal to n lambda into f plus n lambda by 4, or 1 by f is equal to n lambda by R n square, where the higher power of wavelength is ignored in this equation. So you will get f is equal to R n square divided by n lambda, which is also equal to b as in the above equation. Hence, the zone plate has different foci for a different wavelength. Let us make comparison between the zone plate and a convex lens. Because the zone plate behaves like a convex lens, as it has an ability to focus and converge the light rays. Let us take up the comparison. First one, both the zone plate and convex lens forms a real image of the object. Second, the focal length in both depends on wavelength of light used, and both show chromatic aberration, and the chromatic aberration is severe in zone plate when compared to convex lens. Third, a zone plate acts as a convex lens and a concave lens, because in addition to real image, a virtual image is also formed simultaneously. In case of zone plate, the image is due to diffraction phenomenon, and in case of convex lens, the image is due to refraction of light. Fifth, the zone plate has multiple foci on either side of the plate, and hence the intensity of the image formed will be much less. But the convex lens has only one focus, and the intensity in convex lens, that intensity of the image will be very high. Sixth, a zone plate can be used over a wide range of wavelengths from microwave to X-rays, but convex lens cannot be used beyond the visible region. And seventh, in a zone plate, waves reaching the image point through any two alternate zones differ in path difference by lambda. And in case of convex lens, all the rays reaching the image point have a zero path difference. Here I come to the end of the session, and we now have a clear picture about Fresnel's half period zones and construction of zone plates. For your further understanding, you could refer Optics textbooks by Brishlan and Subramaniam and Optics by Ajay Ghatak. Thank you.